Everybody go respect the shooter, but the one in front of the gun lives forever. The one. Everybody gonna respect the shooter, the one that's in front of him, you gotta respect forever. Oh my god. Oh my god. That sounds like something wrong, but I mean, that's great. The way he, oh my god. Oh my god. Yeesh. Oh my god. That bar is deep. Holy cow. In front of the gun,
and I've been hustling all day, this away, that away, through canals and alleyways, just to say money trees is the perfect place for shade, and that's just how I feel.
Money trees is the perfect way for shade, bro. That's how he feels. Ooh, I like this one. I like this one. More than you, and this is more than you, and your entire blood is slandering, abusing. And he said, "This music is more than you." Like, how are you gonna criticize something that's bigger than what you understand? Like, which. Honestly, an average listener of hip-hop would not understand something like The Good Kid, Mad City and what he did throughout that entire project. I need him. That has to be the next album review I need to make. That one has to come out before the end of the year. I promise you guys. That album review will come out before the end of this year. Or not before the end of the year, before the end of the month. Now, I know what y'all guys are gonna say. I broke my promise, and I know that, and I feel super horrible about it. But I've just been busy recently, and I didn't want to give half effort into one of the best projects I have ever heard. Not just as just for Kendrick Lamar, just in hip hop in general. Good Kid, Mad City might be one of the strongest solid build albums ever. If you guys have never heard of this album, then y'all really need to after this review. Or just stop the review right now and just listen to the album, please. It's a masterpiece. What's up, guys? My name is GlitchyBro23 here. I have a fake mic, and today we're going to be reviewing Good Kid, Mad City by Kendrick Lamar. Just gave me her next tail, dropped the number, we chirped the whole summer, and well, the summer had passed, and now I'm liking the conversation we having, probably enticing her. Kendrick opens this album up by taking us back to his days of youth living in Compton. He meets a girl named Sherane at a house party, and after talking to her during the summer, he learns about her family's shady past. However, just like any teenage male, his motivation for some sex leads him to steal his mom's van late at night to go get him some. As he approaches her house, the track cuts off as two strangers approach Kendrick. He ends up missing a phone call from his mother, which is a running theme throughout the Good Kid, Mad City project. She's mad at Kenny because he's out later than what he said he'd be, and that he better not be messing with Sherane in the first place. The way Kendrick flows over the beat to give such an in-depth chapter of this story, along with a handful of clever bars, is executed perfectly. After his dad adds some comedy complaining about not having some dominoes, Kenny's dad ends the track by saying the name of the next track. Things I don't understand, sometimes I need to be alone. Bitch don't kill my vibe, bitch don't kill my vibe. For this track, Kendrick speaks from the present time. No, not now, I mean Kendrick from 2012. When he was making this album, K-Dot harmonizes one of my favorite choruses on the entire project with additional vocals from Anna Wise, where he expresses how he came up and how he's angry about the next generation of rappers who's different from him and just doing it for the money.
As the first track that I've ever heard from Kendrick, this was an instant banger for me. His flow over the two verses, the wordplay, the production, and how he demonstrates how unique of an artist he is, this track has so much replay value for me. All my niggas is winning, screaming all my life. I want money and power, respect my mind, or die from this shout. I pray my dick get. We go back to Teenage Kendrick, where he freestyles in the backseat, obviously, with his friends. As an immature teenager, Kenny expresses how he wants money, women, and power. While he still delivers the bars and comical factor of a freestyle, this track shows how his motives have changed significantly since his upcoming. This is one of the few tracks on the album that I wasn't the biggest fan of on my first few listens, but now I quite enjoy hearing this funky and careless side of him.
Of the working world, we poured up on a bunch of working girls and asked them what they're working with. Look at me, I got the blunt in my mouth. Usually I'm drug free, but shit, I'm with the homies.
As someone who doesn't fold peer pressure, this track gets me intrigued every time I hear it. While with his bad influence of friends, Kendrick ends up drinking and smoking. While under the influence, he hangs out with multiple hood rats, as his mother puts it, commits violent acts, and almost gets caught by the police while him and his friends were robbing a house. The narrative of how he builds up the events throughout this track keeps the listeners on their toes and really places them into either young Kenny's shoes or in one of his friends. This was an awesome concept of the song and really continues the story of this night through the Mad City.
Magic rock up in them projects where them niggas pick your pockets. Santa Claus don't miss them stockings. Liquor spilling, pistols popping, baking soda.
Money Trees continues after Kendrick just slept with Sherane and goes to tell his friends. Then he uses a figurative money tree to explain how he wants money, but eventually he learns more money won't take him away from the problems he faces living in Compton, like the death of his uncle. Finally, after another beautiful feature from Anna, J-Rock hops on the beat and absolutely murders his verse. Honestly, a lot of Kendrick fans, including myself, has to admit that J-Rock completely bodied this track. He speaks about trying to make a living from selling drugs, but even that's difficult when your only source of income is from the government, who J-Rock fears will put him in jail for committing illegal acts to survive. And J-Rock's flow? Oh my god, it's untouchable. Overall, Money Trees is not only one of my favorite tracks that I've reacted to, but one of my favorite hip-hop tracks ever. And I know just, know just what you want. Poetic justice, put it in a song, alright. Serving as the love song for this project, Kendrick brings Drake on Poetic Justice to dedicate this song to Sherane. For those of you who don't know, I'm not the biggest fan of Drake, but I love how both of them collaborate on this one and flow over this instrumental beautifully. Specifically, Kendrick's last verse is very interesting as he uses many literature and poetic bars that fit with the theme of the track. At the end of the track, we hear the two strangers from the end of the opening track threatening Kendrick, kidnap him, and steal his mother's van. Continuing from the previous track where the strangers drive Kendrick through Compton, he feels hopeless that he won't be saved from any cops because of the environment that he lives in and the fact that he's a black kid from Compton. In the setting of this album, Compton was known as one of the scariest parts of California. It was survival of the fittest. However, it was known for gang activity and crimes constantly occurring. Then the strangers take Kendrick to this house where they are growing marijuana, mushrooms, and Xanax. At this point, we hear how scary Compton truly is, especially for a good kid like Kendrick.
Ain't no threat, you moving backwards if you suggest that you sleep with a tech. Go buy your chopper and have a doctor on speed dial, I guess. Mad City.
Bend down, where you from?
After using good kids to depict the truth behind the street life of Compton, Kendrick uses Mad City to depict how the public sees Compton, while also diving into some real personal details, like who killed his cousin. After an incredible beat switch, we hear an eerie tone from Kendrick as he begs for his life to MC Eiht, who portrays as a Compton gangster and the man who killed K-Dot's cousin. Next, MC Eiht tells a teenage Kendrick about his upcoming as a gangster and how much of a thug he really is. Then Kendrick makes up a fictional story about how he has killed someone before, and he ends up leaving with his life, but is traumatized. We also learn from the final line of the track what mad means. For the longest time, I have slept on the content and story behind this track, and I just added this track to my Best of Kendrick Lamar playlist as I was writing this script. Finally, we hear Kenny's friends pick him up and offer him alcohol to ease his pain. sorry, breaking the fourth wall here, but to clear up any like confusion about the track list and like the events happening in chronological order, here is an official, like, from an official website, the sequence of events that have been happening throughout these tracks.
Frank.
Faded.
Now I done grew around some people living their life in bottles. Granddaddy had the golden flask, backstroke every day in Chicago. Some people like the way it feels.
Released initially as a standalone single, Kendrick uses swimming pools to describe how he views the effects of alcohol and why he doesn't drink because of his family's history of alcoholism. But in the context of this album, Kendrick ends up getting drunk anyways, to where he starts having a conversation with his conscience, saying that if he takes one more drink, he'll achieve nothing in life. One thing that bugs me about this track is that the chorus repeats way too often. But other than that, it's crazy how the track ends, with him and his friends getting into a shootout with the gang that kidnapped Kendrick earlier. However, after they evacuate, they realize their homie Dave has been shot dead.
Lost shit, my sister died in vain, but what point are you trying to gain? If you can't fit the pumps, I walk in, I'll wait. Your rebuttal a little too late, and if you have an album, then
well, who said we wasn't, dying of thirst, dying of thirst, dying of thirst, dope on the corner, look at the coroner, daughter is dead.
This two-part track is the pure craftsmanship of a lyricist, and easily one of the album's strongest points of storytelling. In Sing About Me, Kendrick uses the first verse to speak from Dave's perspective, talking about how him and their friends were there for him as family. However, we know what happened to Dave at the end of the last track, and that's how Kendrick ends the first verse. Now, there's some background story behind the second verse. On K-Dawg's debut album, Section 80, he has a track labeled Keisha's Song, Her Pain, where he tells a story that resembles Tupac's Brenda's Got a Baby. So in Sing About Me, he takes the perspective of Keisha's sister, where she criticizes Kendrick for making her sister's tragic situation public to everyone, and even wishes death upon him. Finally, Kendrick uses the last verse to give his perspective about both situations, saying it was beyond scarring to see his friend dead next to him, and why he made Keisha's song despite how embarrassing it was. He states that he made the track to bring awareness to everyone. The complexity and amazing storytelling makes you feel every view that Kendrick was portraying in Sing About Me. Now, the second half of this track, I'm Dying of Thirst, starts with Kenny and his friends angry about Dave's death. While everyone is thinking about going back to kill the gang members, K-Dawg takes in everything that's happened to him tonight and decides to put the flame out on taking the road down becoming a real thug. Then the track ends with an elderly woman hearing the angry commotion from the group, stating that they're dying of thirst and need holy water. She has them say a prayer where they accept God to watch over them, which is what we heard at the beginning of Good Kid, M.A.A.d City. Overall, this 13-minute, two-part track was super deep, personal, honest, and the strongest way Kendrick used to start concluding this album. To close off this album, Kendrick reflects on everything that he witnessed that night while taking the perspective of his teenage self. This is where we completely hear how he turned his life around and how his motives changed with the final verse, stating that he learned money, power, and respect doesn't make him real. Instead, we hear a voicemail from his father saying what makes you real isn't killing a man. What makes you real is responsibility, protecting your family, and God. Then Kendrick's mom leaves the final voicemail saying he needs to take hip-hop seriously, to use music as a platform to encourage the young Hispanic and African Americans in the world, to represent his city and the people who struggle every day, and to give back to the city that he's from, to spread positivity to anyone who's been through a similar situation. This is one of the quote-unquote realest, most honest tracks I've ever heard. So, as soon as I heard this track, I knew this would be on my Best of Kendrick Lamar playlist. And this is officially the end of the story behind Good Kid, M.A.A.d City.
When I come a long way from $100 a month to $100 million in a day, bitch, I'm from
Compton. Ain't no city quite like mine.
Technically, this is the real ending of Good Kid, M.A.A.d City, as it's not only the place after a track where K-Dawg was told to use his music to represent his city, but it also marks the beginning of his new life with the help of his mentor, Dr. Dre. Once again, the doctor was able to find another talented artist and craft him into one of the biggest hip-hop artists ever by producing his album and signing him to Aftermath Interscope. The fact that Kendrick brought Dre out to rap for us makes this track so much cooler. It's amazing how much talented artists Dre has had the opportunity to get them to where they're at, including Eminem, 50 Cent, The Game, and the newest star, Kendrick himself. This track is a hell of a banger and really displays two of Compton's goats, representing their hometown. Then Kendrick really ties this track in with the rest of the album by playing a skit where he tells his mom that he's borrowing her van, which is what she was mad about at the end of Sherane.
Rumors on the ground getting too loud, we turn them shits down. Can't hear myself think. Turbulent shit almost spilled my drink in the white house with a mink. Running through that bitch like it's my house. All up
Kendrick Lamar, Jay-Z, a legendary collab over this insane remix. Honestly, it's very difficult to debate whether the original track is better than the remix or vice versa. Both brought their A game for this track, with insane bars, their signature flows, and both veterans representing their hometowns. I can't imagine how the world reacted when this first dropped after the success of Good Kid, M.A.A.d City. No matter which version you prefer, both versions of Bitch Don't Kill My Vibe are both fucking fire, hands down. So, y'all guys saw that I had a lot of positive things to say about the original 13 tracks for the Good Kid, M.A.A.d City album, and that you saw that most of those tracks were actually added to my Best of Kendrick Lamar playlist. And just the way this story builds on throughout this entire project is incredibly well done and executed for someone who has only, this is their second album in their discography, and this album would start the chain for Kendrick Lamar of albums to go platinum, like, instantly, and become some of the best albums in hip-hop history. So, here's my final rating of the original Good Kid, M.A.A.d City. Now, the deluxe version of the Good Kid, M.A.A.d City isn't much longer. There's about four additional tracks, but I just felt like we should break them down two and two because some people prefer deluxe versions of albums and some don't. And sometimes a deluxe version can weigh down an original album to some fans. So we're going to go ahead and just break down the last four tracks.
Baby, come on, let that trust and roll it up for me when I'm stressed.
You might catch me in Atlanta, looking like a boss.
I will never get tired of Dr. Dre features, especially when he works with stars that he helped push their career to the next levels. The recipe sounds like Kendrick's version of California Love, as him and his mentor describe the benefits of California over this beautiful instrumental. Also, it sounds nice to hear Kendrick sound like he's having fun for once. And personally, the way these two flow over this Cali Fluids beat makes me prefer this collab compared to Compton. Just to make it clear, I don't hate Compton at all, but I just really love this track overall.
For his finals, he had his back like a spinal. Meanwhile, we singing the same old song, spinning the vinyl. 11th graders gone wrong. He focused on the NBA. We focused on some Patron. Now watch that black.
Black Boy Fly sounds like a combination of Good Kid, M.A.A.d City and Kendrick's next album, To Pimp a Butterfly. For this track, Kendrick takes us back to his days as a kid living in Compton. In the first verse, he tells us how he's jealous about Aaron Afflo, a kid who went to his high school and went to the NBA. The next verse, he recalls the days when The Game dropped his debut album, The Documentary, and how he's jealous of his success. However, in the last verse, Kendrick reveals that he's not jealous of either of them, but that he was scared that they were going to be the last big names to represent Compton, and that he himself wouldn't become a star. This track has so much more meaning than I realized, and is another track that I added to my Best of Kendrick Lamar playlist as I was writing this album review. As the first song that I've ever heard from Mary J. Blige. Let's just pause for a bit, okay? I have heard features of Mary J. Blige, but I haven't repeatedly heard them like I heard this track, okay? I know I am uncultured. You don't have to take it. You don't have to remind me. I freaking know. Okay? I'm breaking the fourth wall. But I know. However, she has the voice of an actual angel. No offense, but she makes any female vocalist seem like an amateur. While she sings her ass off, Kendrick sounds very humble while delivering this track about how he feels after reaching the amount of success that he's accomplished. Even though the structure of his verses are a little off, this is another track that I just recently added to my Best of Kendrick Lamar playlist.
I got the recipe. Fly hoes on the road, I guess. Everybody know I got that Yola. Ask Keisha, she'll confess. I wake up, then I bake up. With a bad bitch, she ain't got no makeup.
Compared to the original, the remix of the recipe sounds almost the exact same, but just with different rappers. Like, the structure, bars, and the use of women, weed, and weather lines are practically mirrored. This is one of those remixes that I don't really care for, especially since Kendrick's verse is the exact same. So there was little effort put into making this remix different from the original, and I don't hate this track, I just find it unnecessary to be on this project. I guess that's why it's only a bonus track though. So, with the deluxe version having a total of 17 tracks, this is how I rank the deluxe version of Good Kid, M.A.A.d City compared to the original. Now, I have some valid reasons on why I gave the deluxe version of Good Kid, M.A.A.d City a lower rating compared to the original. For one, we're only given 4 bonus tracks, which don't have nothing to do with the original story of the album. Second of all, 3 of the 4 tracks sound like something we've heard on the album originally. The Recipe sounds like a sequel to Compton. Now or Never sounds like a combination of Bitch Don't Kill My Vibe and Money Trees. And then the Recipe remix is just, I guess, a trilogy to Compton. The only track from the deluxe version that sounds somewhat unique is Black Boy Fly. So there you guys have it. That is my full final thoughts on Good Kid, M.A.A.d City. It was a beautiful project overall, and I am just so happy that my friends introduced me to Kendrick Lamar finally. I knew Kendrick was up there as one of those like lyricists, but I'm so glad that my friends gave me the suggestions when I was first doing the reactions, because then I also built the fan base with you guys. So it's just, this project means so much to me. Like, reaction-wise and personally, because it's just such a solid album. It really is. Like, I don't know. I don't know what to, if you guys don't enjoy this album, I do not know what to tell you. It's impossible. Impossible to hate on this album. And it's debatable whether this is better than To Pimp a Butterfly, which, if you guys want me to react to any songs on that, let me know in the comment section right now. But other than that, thank you guys so much for watching. If you guys enjoyed, be sure to hit that like button, subscribe if you're new. And y'all guys want more Kendrick, let me know in the comment section. Like I said, you know, these take a lot of time and effort, so I really appreciate it if you guys share this with any other Kendrick fans or anybody who loves these album reviews. Because yeah, I've been holding this one back for a while, but I was finally glad that I got it done for you guys. So thank y'all for watching. And I'll see you guys next time.